All right. Congratulations, freshmen. You've made it through your first full day. Let's say a prayer as we begin this session together so that the energy is high and that you don't fall asleep on me. I'm an extrovert. I get energy from other people. So if you don't laugh when I'm funny, if you don't nod appreciatively when I say something profound, if you're not with me, my energy is going to dip and this whole thing's not going to be nearly as good. So that's why we had you standing. The lights are a little dark. I'm a little worried about it, honestly, but we'll deal with it. So let's pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Lord Jesus, we love you, and we praise you, and we thank you. Lord, I pray that you would send your Holy Spirit upon us, and that tonight we would give you glory and honor, and that everything good, beautiful, and true that I say would be remembered, and anything not would be quickly forgotten. Amen. 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 Take a seat. I'm very excited to be with all of you. My wife, five kids, and I traveled down to Ave yesterday. A couple of my kids and some of my nieces and nephews are hanging out over there. Everyone turn around and say hi to them. Hello. Yep. They're super cute. My kids are cuter than yours, for sure. And I stand by that. And I'm excited to be with you. This is going to be an important few days for you as freshman orientation, and I hope our time together tonight and throughout the course of the other evenings can be a moment where you can just sit, receive. But did my voice just crack? I think it did. Yeah. I've been dealing with a cold. That's a dangerous thing for a speaker but don't worry. I'm so confident we're going to just fly right through it. Okay. To sit, receive, but to be ready. And what do I need you to be ready for? I just need you to be ready for the fact that I believe and the leaders of Ave Maria University believe, and your student leaders believe, that Jesus has something for you in these sessions. That wherever you're coming from, whatever you believe, whatever baggage you've brought into this seat, whatever fears, whatever hopes, whatever dreams, all that, the Lord has something for you in this time. And so you can check out if you want. You're in college now, right? Your parents, well, I guess your parents are still here. But generally, soon they won't be here, and a lot of your decisions are going to be your own. So I'm not going to force you to sit up straight, though I am a speaker that will notice when people start to fall asleep or start to slouch a little bit, and I may or may not call you out on it. But I'm not going to force you to, like, believe something over the next few minutes. But I'm going to invite you to be open to it, okay? And if you're open to it, I really believe that the Lord will speak. So let's start with a little story. So a few years ago, more than I care to admit, before I met my wife, before we had five kids in that order, wife, then kids, important thing. I was at the University of Michigan, and believe it or not, I was a member of the Michigan men's basketball team, which I know is hard to believe as a 6-foot white guy, but please wait for the facts, okay? My freshman year, I tried out for the team, and it didn't make it, which was okay. They asked me to be a manager, which was great. I got to travel with the team, and we went to Duke and UCLA and Alaska and all the Big Ten schools, and I was practicing with the team every day. And then my sophomore year, we had coaching change, and this time, by some miracle, I was put on the official NCAA roster, which meant I was on the team, I was practicing every day. In the eyes of the NCAA, I was a member of the team. But the Big Ten had rules about how many guys could dress for the game, so I didn't have a uniform yet. And then a couple really good things happened for me. A couple guys got hurt. a couple guys transferred off the team, and next thing you know, I'm standing in Coach Bayline's office, and he's somewhat begrudgingly saying, "Pete, I need you to dress for the game tomorrow." And on the outside, I play it totally cool. You know, I'm like, "Yeah, coach, whatever you need." On the inside, I'm freaking out. You see, this is everything I'd ever wanted. I grew up in Ann Arbor. My parents had met at the University of Michigan. My dad had been a baseball player at Michigan. He was the MVP his senior year. My grandfather had been a gymnast at Michigan. My great-grandfather had played football at Michigan. Fun fact, he played center in the first ever Green Bay Packers-Chicago Bears game, the center. Yeah. I don't know why you're clapping. He's very dead, but it's cool. Any guess on how much he weighed as the center for the Packers back then? 154 pounds. Some of you don't get why that's weird. And some of you, probably the kicker on the football team, is like, "I have a chance." And you're like, "No, you don't, man. You are destined to still kick." And that's good. It's an important role, right? Right? Yeah, for sure. Okay. So anyway, maize and blue runs through my veins. This is everything I've ever wanted. And Coach Bieline says, "Go see Bob, the equipment manager, and he'll get you set up for the game tomorrow." So I skip down the hallway to Bob, and I say, "Bob, did you hear the good news? I'm dressing for the game tomorrow." And Bob's this old curmudgeon-y guy. He's been around forever. And he said, yeah. He said, "Well, you're going to have to take whatever uniform I have for you because I didn't have a chance to order you one." I said, "Bob, listen, as long as it says Michigan on the front, we're good." So Bob rummages around the closet. Bob pulls out double XL number 53 with no name on the back. Not ideal, you know, no little boy dreams of being number 53. Double XL came to about here, so I tucked that bad boy in, and this is back when big shorts were still cool, so I was like wearing a tent and pretty happy about it, okay? First game was at Northwestern. It went off without a hitch. It was great. I didn't get in the game, which was ideal. I shot the lights out in warm-ups, so much so that the beat writers for the newspaper actually mentioned it in their column. They said, 5'8", Pete Burak, shot really well in warm-ups. And I was like, come on, guys, like, you're going to shave off some inches already? I'm already short enough as it is. And I did my job. And what's my job? Literally every single basketball team, it's required, including the NBA, has a little white guy at the end of the bench who goes crazy when somebody else hits the three, right? If you've watched any amount of basketball, there's that little guy at the end who's got the dances and everything, all the chest bumps, all the handshakes. That was me, and I was really good at it, okay? Some of you are wondering where this story is going. Just bear with me, okay? It has a point. So, second game was at Illinois. Illinois plays in an arena called Assembly Hall. Assembly Hall is known for lots of things, but one of the things is the student section stands the entire game about this far, literally like 4 feet from the visiting bench, which is just the best, you know, because they really make you feel welcome. You learn all sorts of new words, and it's just like it's a real confidence boost when you're the visiting team. And so this particular game, we were wearing our maize uniforms. Maize is yellow. We call it maize at Michigan because we're elitist, but it's yellow, okay? So you have to imagine maize uniform, double XL, number 53, no name on the back with a white warm-up shirt, which is the key detail. So the game begins. I'm doing my job, loving my life, sitting at the end of the bench, cheering on my guys. Maize uniform, double XL, number 53, no name on the back, white warm-up shirt. Kind of just happy to be there, okay? It's about halfway through the second half. In this particular year, Illinois was very good, and we were not. And so they were up by, I don't know, 15 or 20 points, and I'm sitting there, maize uniform, double XL, number 53, no name on the back, white warm-up shirt, leaning forward like this, and it's a dead ball, and so kind of a boring moment in the game, and the arena's kind of quiet. And I think you know this by now, but I'll just reiterate. I was sitting there, maize uniform, double XL, number 53, no name on the back, white warm-up shirt, kind of leaning forward like this. And all of a sudden, this voice shouts out from behind me. Number 53, number 53, who are you? You see, he had looked down on the back of my uniform, and there was no name on the back. Turns out I wasn't in the program yet, so he was kind enough to ask me. I ignored him, as I had been trained to do, of course. And I think the moment's over, and then all of a sudden I hear, 53, 53, whose uniform did you steal, you know? 53, are you supposed to be here, you know? And now my teammates are starting to nudge me, and I'm like, shut up, pay attention to the game. And I think the moment's over, and I'm just kind of settled in, ready for the game to start again. And then to my horror, and this is a true story, this very slow but steady sound begins to build behind me. 53, 53, 53, 53. And you guys are nearly college students at this point. You'll learn. You'll chant anything, right? As long as it's to that rhythm, you're probably going to join in as long as your friends start joining in. And so within about 27 seconds, most of the lower bowl of the arena is chanting, 53, 53. And I'm in this new circle of hell I didn't know existed. I'm sweating. I'm like, oh my gosh, how is this my life? And I thought it couldn't get any worse, but it did, because the chanting shifted from 53, 53, and this is true, to put him in, put him in. So I'm freaking out. I'm like, oh my gosh. And all of a sudden, somehow the chanting gets louder. 53, put him in. The crowd is in a lather, and I glance down the bench, and wouldn't you know it, sure enough, Coach Beilein has risen out of his seat. And he's begun to walk very intentionally down the bench towards me. And as he gets closer, they get louder. 53, put him in, right? And I'm avoiding eye contact at all costs. Because nobody wants to get in the game, literally for the very first time. It'd been like, now in the game for Michigan, number 53. That guy, you know? They wouldn't have known who I was. So he gets to it from, a foot away from me. The crowd is in a full, 53, because you know what they're thinking too, right? They already assumed they were going to win, but they were like, if that guy gets in the game, we know for sure we've won, right? It's like a inverse human victory cigar. So they stretch out their hand as if he's going to put me in the game. I look up at him with what must have been the most pathetic look on my face. And he gets this little smile on his face, and he goes and he sits down. Oh. And I melted into a puddle of gratitude. I could have kissed him in that moment. I was just, oh. And the crowd, just loudest cheer of the night, boo, you know. Oh, yeah, okay. So why do I tell that story? One, it's a little bit funny. And everybody knows you should always start a talk with something funny. Pro tip. Second is, I know there's some basketball players out there because they were walking in holding the ball like any good basketball player would. And basketball players all have the same walk. It's different than football players. We all know this. Football players walk around campus as if they're God's gift to campus. They truly believe they are Adonis in our midst, and they stand with their shoulders just a little too wide. We get it. You do the bench press. We're all aware that you need to push and pull. Right, okay. But they walk like this, right? Basketball players don't walk like that. Basketball players usually have a hood on, generally. And we got more of a slide to us because we look like we're always sore. Because we just ran a lot at practice. We want everybody to know that the way we sit down, oh yeah, we always sit down the same way. You'll notice them at mass, they're like, everyone else, it's like at the time of mass where everyone's supposed to kneel, the basketball player will be the last one to get down there because, oh man, it was a burner today, right? And we do everything slowly because we're so fast on the court, yeah. Anyway, so I noticed a couple of the basketball players walking in. So second reason I tell the story is mainly so I can connect with you guys and to let you know I can still take you. Third. That's real. So some of that went right past and people didn't notice that one. Okay. Third reason is this. And ultimately to kind of launch us into what I want to talk about. What's really interesting about my time at Michigan and my time wearing a uniform as I reflected on it. And a few years after that, I found myself in adoration. I was sitting before the Lord and I was just wasting time with Jesus. Why? Because I wanted to be with him. And I had real faith, but I didn't have an agenda. I was just kind of sitting there with him. And as I was sitting there with him, this memory of Illinois game and the number 53 and the chanting came to mind. And whenever a memory like this comes to me in prayer, I always ask Jesus, what's it about? You know, like, what do you want to tell me about this? And so as I kind of said, Jesus, what's this one about? I felt like Jesus asked me a question. And it wasn't like an audible voice, right? It was just that still small voice of the Spirit. Where Jesus said something, a thought popped into my heart that I knew wasn't my own. As I reflected on that story, I felt like Jesus said, Pete, why didn't you want to get in the game? Why didn't you want to get in the game? And you know, it's interesting. I immediately thought of every reason why I probably should not have been the one in the game. You know, I probably wasn't really actually good enough. I wasn't really wearing the right thing. I thought, you know, what if I'd thrown the ball out of bounds or forgotten a play or something? What was fascinating, though, is I'd grown up a fan of the team. And I had watched the team, and I had worked really, really hard to make the team and to be on the team. And I loved doing the things that the team did. I loved practice and training table and the weight room and study hall and the film session. I loved it all. And I loved cheering for the guys who were in the game. But when it came time to do the thing the team exists to do, which is win basketball games, I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to do it. I loved clapping for the guys who were in the game. I would have written a check for us to win the game. I was all in hypothetically about us winning, but I didn't want to do it. And what the Lord showed me was that was exactly how I was approaching my life with him. I loved being on Jesus's team. I loved doing the things that Jesus' team does, right? I knew when to stand, I knew when to sit. I would go to mass and I would occasionally pray the rosary and then the ADD would kick in and I would stop praying the rosary and I'd get through about a decade and a half and then, you know, something would happen around me and I'd forget and then I'd be moving on. Or, you know, I would read the Bible occasionally. I loved being on Jesus' team. And if somebody asked me, Pete, are you Catholic? I would have said, yes, absolutely. But over and over and over and over again, when it came time to doing the thing that Jesus' team exists to do, which is to seek and save the lost, to proclaim liberty to captives, to bring people from darkness to light, from death to life, or the fancy word for this is to evangelize, to make disciples. Over and over and over again, when it came time for me to do anything outward focused, public facing, I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to get in the game. And so here's why I start here. We're going to talk about living a story. And more specifically, what story are you going to let form your life? What story are you going to participate in? But we're going to get serious right off the bat. And I'm going to ask you, where are you at with Jesus? Who is Jesus to you? And I'm not asking for somebody to stand up right now and do a public proclamation. That would be cool, but I'm not asking for it. I'm not asking because I'm trying to manipulate the situation or try to get you into a vulnerable spot where now you're going to respond. No, no, no. I just want to ask you the question because it's the thing that's most important to me. And it's the reason my five kids and I schlepped all the way down here. I mean, you guys are cool, but it's hot down here, you know? And we left like lake life in Michigan to come down here. Why? Because it's important to me. And it's important to this university that you wrestle with, grapple with, and have to answer the question, who is Jesus to you? I want that just to linger with you. I want it to just settle on you. I want it to just kind of rattle around in your brain over the next few days. And when I see you again on Saturday, we'll talk more about that question. So let that rattle as I share what I'm about to talk about now, okay? Everybody stand up. I'm not going to let the energy drop, friends. I'm a former gym teacher, so we have some dodgeballs coming in. No, I'm kidding. Though that would have been fun. So everybody do one of these. Do one of these. Yeah, maybe even if you want, you can put your hands on your hips. Yep. We call that one the washing machine. Yep. My kids know what I'm doing. Yep. All right, that's enough of that. Sit back down. Watch the basketball players. All right. So whether you realize it or not, every single one of us is living in a competition, in darn near a battle between two stories, two narratives, or more maybe kind of intensely, two kingdoms. There are two different versions of reality that each human being has to wrestle with. And throughout all of human history, this has been the case. And throughout all of human history, every individual person has to wrestle with, what story am I living? What story do I believe? And so I want to lay out there the two stories for you. And then I'm going to share my story of how I've come to believe the kingdom story. The kingdom of light story, I should say, instead of the kingdom of darkness story, okay? So here's one story. This is the story that I'm just going to put under the header of the world, which I know is a super annoying Catholic youth ministry thing to do, be like, the world. But we're going to lump everything not Christianity in one category, which is super unfair, I realize, and you'll have all sorts of nuanced classes that will unpack each other, just for the sake of tonight, okay? For the sake, I only have a few minutes. Give me some slack. The world. And then we'll say, Jesus, because that's the Catholic school answer to everything else, right? So the world, and if you don't know the answer, Jesus, it's always right. Okay, so the world. What's the story of the world? The story of the world starts like this. You are good, just as you are. And your feelings are trustworthy. What you feel about yourself is your authentic self. And the journey of life and the project of life is to discover, to unpack, and even, here's a college word for you, curate for yourself what it means to be you. But you are the master of your domain. You are the hero of your story. And the world, in a particular way, revolves around you. And as long as your version of you isn't too difficult for other people to handle, as long as you're not hurting anyone, whatever way you define yourself, whatever way you understand yourself, whatever way you want yourself to be, is the authentic you. But then the world says something else. The world says, you are lovable, and you are loved. And then the world puts this big little word at the end of that phrase. You are lovable, you are loved, if. If. So the project is to create yourself, to curate your own life, to discover your feelings, to discover your authentic self, and to live then as freely in that self as possible, because the ultimate purpose of life in the eyes of the world is to be happy. And in order to be happy, you have to be free. And in order to be free, you have to be able to do whatever you want, whenever you want, with whomever you want, as much as you want, as long as everyone's consenting. And as long as everybody kind of agrees that it's okay. But you're lovable and you're loved if you do the right thing. If you make a lot of money. If that guy looks at me as I walk across the cafeteria. That's how I know I'm lovable. You're lovable if that girl will say yes by the end of the night. You're lovable if you are loved if the win-loss record looks pretty good. You're lovable if you're loved if you make the team. It's all these behaviors, it's all these outcomes, it's all you and your worth and your identity is self-generated and confirmed only if behavior and other people's opinions and support and your perception of those things all line up. And then, the world says, and then, if all that happens, you know your authentic self, it's validated by others, you've answered the if question, if you're able to successfully do that, at the end of all that, what's the promise? You'll be happy because you'll be free and you'll be fully the person you really are. And man, isn't that an attractive worldview? Isn't that easy to kind of go like, yeah, I could get behind that. Like, yeah, I want to be successful. I want to make the team. I'd totally love it if the girl said yes. I'd be totally fine if the guy glanced this way. A's on tests are pretty big deal in college, you know? Yeah, there's something attractive about this. There's something that in the human heart kind of is drawn towards this narrative, is drawn towards this outcome-driven narrative, this self-reliant, outcome-driven narrative. The story is it's all about me. It's all about who I can become. It's all about how I understand myself and then whether or not I get the job done and whether or not people see it. There's something that's attractive about that. And I can tell you, well, I'll wait. Let's talk about the other story. What's the other story? The Jesus story. The gospel narrative. The scriptural understanding of reality. How's it start? You are very good. You are very good. When God creates creation, when the Father creates everything, he's like, good, 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 humanity, very good. I'm like, wow, all right, well done, us, you know? Good, 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 very good. There's a theology teacher who just cringed by how I said that, but that's okay, you know? We're working with it. Football players are with me, yep. They're like, yeah, I get that, yep, uh-huh, yeah. Yeah, sorry, guys, that's all right. Low-hanging fruit. You were just hitting each other with tortillas up here. I mean, come on. Which, by the way, was there a little bit of, like, venom behind a couple of those slaps? I mean, it was like all fun and games, and then all of a sudden I was walking backstage, literally about that far behind, like in the middle of that wall, behind the wall, and I heard a pop. And I thought, whoa, okay. And you could tell, too, by the reaction of all the rest of you, some of the other ones were like, oh, 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 you know, that was... It shifted quickly, yeah. They're still bros, though. That's good, because they love coffee. Okay. God says, good, 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 very good. Very good. But here's where it changes. Why are we very good? Because we're made in his image and likeness. We are good because he is good. But then we also know where the story goes. What was once very good, what was designed very good, very quickly, something changes. Sin enters into the equation. And sin changes the whole dynamic. Instead of Adam and Eve living in and believing their very goodness instead of them living in and believing that this is how they were created and being humble in that and confident in that and obedient in that, they rebel. They say no. They listen to that stupid lie. Did God really say that? So much of life is that little lie. Did God really say that? Did God really say that? Friends, I promise you, anytime you hear, did God really say that, at the end of that sentence, there's nothing helpful at the end of that sentence. Did God really say that? Yes, he really did say things. And it's important to listen to it. Because when we don't, when we rebel, sin enters the equation, and what happens? What is very good becomes very bad. We are separated from God. Sin creates a crack, a separation from us and God. We who are once sons and daughters of God by the very nature of our existence now become friends, and this is a big difference from the world. We are born into this world. This is going to get a little intense. Hang with me. We are born into this world, all of us, as sons and daughters of wrath. And that's not my idea, so please don't shoot the messenger unless you have to. That's what Scripture tells us. That because of sin, death entered into the world. And we are born under a curse. The wages of sin is death. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So all of us are born actually under a curse. A curse that we, by ourselves, can't do anything about. No amount of just good behavior and willing it and just kind of going, I want to get out from under it. No, that's not going to free us. Do you see the difference? The world says you're good, and actually, you're so good, just dive deeper into yourself. God says, I love you and I made you good, but because of sin, something needs to be saved in you. Something needs to be done in you that you can't do yourself. So what do we know? That God in his love and in his mercy and in his plan sends his son to take on human flesh. To take on that curse, to become a son of wrath under a curse, and to take that to the cross. And on the cross, what do we see in Jesus? What we see is the effect of the true identity of men and women. By being a son or daughter of wrath, that is what we deserve. That is our destiny. Death, suffering, despair, total abject failure. And Jesus does this because he loves us. Because he loves us. And what we know happens after this, and thank goodness he rose from the dead, because if he didn't rise from the dead, we'd all be a bunch of fools. There would be nothing more foolish than Christianity if Jesus died and did not come back. Because he takes on what is due for us, the curse and the effect of that curse, and the identity of the cursed, and the destiny of the curse, and he takes that to hell, and he breaks it through his own goodness and his own holiness. The power of sin and death could not hold him down, and he rises from the dead, and now he turns to all mankind. He turns to everyone and says, do you want this life? Do you want the solution? Do you want the antidote? And the antidote is me, he says. Be crucified with me so that you might rise with me. Be baptized so your sins might be forgiven, so that God might live in you. Yeah, I know this is intense, friends, but this is what it means to be human. This is what it means to understand the dynamic between the kingdom of darkness and the kingdom of light. And I'm not going to let you off the hook just because we had a fun time and hit each other with tortillas. Well, some of us did. We have to understand what we're really living in. The kingdom of the world is all about a sense of freedom driven from ourselves that leads actually to slavery, that leads to death, and does not have a solution for death. The world doesn't know how to deal with death. So what does the world do? It tries to distract us. Don't worry about it. You're young. You're 18. Or some of you might be older or younger. I don't know. You're of age around here. But don't worry about it. Watch this show. Watch all of these shows. Watch all of these shows and more shows. You know? Netflix is amazing. Every time I go on there, I'm like, I want to watch all of this. How do you know that, Netflix? And the Netflix is like, we got you. Right? And it's like, And what's the point of all that? To just distract us, to just keep us not thinking about, like, oh yeah, I might die someday, you know? Nobody wants to think about that. I mean, who invited this guy? Who would you? I guarantee you, you did not come in here thinking that we'd be talking about death. Hello, President Mindorf. No, but the point is, the world has no solution, no option, no good story to tell or to invite you into the death problem. And the whole reason Christianity is so compelling, the whole reason Christianity has lived and people have literally died for it and bled for it and built universities for it, is because we have a solution. We have a hope. We have a joy in Jesus Christ. That we who were once dead are now alive. That we actually know what's coming. We actually believe what's coming. And we can respond to it. I forgot to check my watch when I first started talking, so I have no idea how long I've been going, which is super fun, especially for a preacher. Now all of you got really uncomfortable. No, I actually do. I know. That's like an old trick when I'm just trying to take a deep breath. Okay. We have a solution, and it's Jesus Christ. And so the question, friends, as I started with, is who is Jesus? And maybe the next question is, and what are you going to do about him? And what kingdom are you going to live in? And what story are you going to believe? The story of the world or the story of Christianity, of the church? The story of freedom, personalization, happiness, make it your own? Or the story of surrender, obedience, a laying down so that we could be brought back up? Those are the two options. And I can promise you, some of you, and I know this because I did this, are going to try to live one foot in the kingdom of the church, the kingdom of light, and one foot in the world. We're going to do one of these actions. We're going to sometimes be over here and sometimes be over here. When it's convenient, we're going to, yeah, like, yeah, the world. And then when it's not, oh, yeah, Christianity. And we're going to go back and forth. And I just want to tell you, and I get it, you're freshmen, so the likelihood of you listening to me on this is small. Because no freshman ever is like, yeah, I want to hear from a 35-year-old man life advice. But I'm just telling you, if you try to live by both stories, if you try to live in both kingdoms, it won't work. It won't work. So here's my story of how I found that out. One more time, just for fun, everybody stand up, give somebody a side hug, a high five, an Ave hug, yep, maybe one of those butt out hugs, yeah, yeah, we don't want to get too close. Maybe a bro hug if you got it. I promise this is the last time I'll have you do this. I promise. There we go, yep, a little fist bump. Oh, I didn't even think about a fist bump. That's good, little fist bump. All right, sit back down, sit back down. Sit back down. Two-a-days right now? Football guys? No, just one. When's your first game? September 2nd. Who are you playing? Lawrence. Hey, that's a Michigan team, right? Are you going up to Michigan? Dude, we should totally go. That's like 25 minutes. Kate, or Gracie, write that down, please. That's the 11-year-old. She might actually write it down. Okay. So, here we go. Close out our little bit of time. I got about 10 minutes. So here's my 10-minute testimony of how I tried to live in both kingdoms and it didn't work. So I grew up in what I came to find out was a pretty extraordinary Catholic family. And what I mean by that is we went to Mass every Sunday. We prayed the rosary way too much. And both my parents really believed. They really believed that Jesus was the Lord. They really believed the whole Catholic thing, and they showed it to us. I mean, I remember when I used to have to make a decision about things, I would go to my mom and say, Mom, what do you think I should do? And my mom would say, well, have you asked Jesus what he wants you to do? And I'd be like, no, I didn't. And she'd be like, well, go ask Jesus and tell me what he says. And I'd go off down my room and pretend to pray and then come back and be like, I think he wants me to do this. And she'd be like, well, okay, well, I think you should do this. And I was like, you're going to do that all the whole time. You know, why'd we go through that exercise? So anyway, the point is, faith was a big part of our family's life and a big part of the community that we lived in. But if you had asked me at 9 years old, Pete, what is most important to you? I would have said sports. I love sports. I loved every sport. as I already talked about, my dad had been a baseball player at Michigan, so my favorite sport was baseball. And I was a good little baseball player at 9 years old. I was the pitcher and the catcher. I was the quarterback at recess. I had a really good throwing arm. And after one particular game, I came home and my shoulder was sore, which when you're 9 years old, nothing should ever be sore. So it was a little confusing. And so we went to the doctor, and I'll never forget this, sitting in the doctor's office, one of those early defining moments of my life. Dr. Voitis came in and he said, Pete, I'm very sorry to tell you this, but you have a rare condition called epiphysitis, which is just a fancy word for pain, okay? And that pain is not going to go away until probably you're 18 years old when your growth plate closes. He said, so I'm sorry, buddy, you're not going to be able to throw any sort of ball with your right arm until you're, you know, out of high school. And which doesn't sound that dramatic, right? But for a little 9-year-old boy, all I wanted to be was a baseball player. I had so much pride in my throwing arm to all of a sudden not be able to throw at all without really serious pain. I couldn't even raise my arm above my head without really hurting. It was like my whole little world exploded, okay? And so after about 2 weeks of my parents watching me mope around the house, they sat me down in the living room and they called it a come to Jesus meeting. They said, Pete, we know you're suffering. We know this is really hard for you. And they said, well, the only way you're going to be happy, the only way you're going to be fulfilled is if you give your life to Jesus. And, you know, I trusted them because I'd watched them do this. And so I went into my bedroom and I knelt down by my bed and I got in the position every little kid knows is the proper prayer position, like this. And I said, Jesus, I love you and I give you my life. And the sky opened up and a dove descended. No, nothing happened, right? I didn't feel anything. I didn't get healed. There was nothing dramatic that happened. But all of a sudden, as days went by, there was this peace in my life because I knew I was living for someone other than myself. And there was a peace that came with that. Until one day after going to Mass on Sunday, I had received communion and I was praying in the pew. And I had just started to have these profound experiences of Jesus. And I don't even know how to explain it. Like, I can't be like, yeah, I knew I had met Jesus because of X, Y, and Z. I just knew, like, in this region, that he was real. I just became convinced that Jesus was real and that he loved me. That Jesus is real and he loved me. At 9 years old, it just was like blowing my mind, you know? And I just knew it. I just knew it. So one day I had received Holy Communion and I was praying with the Lord and I felt like Jesus asked me a question. It was the first time I had ever really heard him kind of like speak to me. And he said, Pete, will you suffer for me? Will you suffer for me? And I loved him so much, and I knew he loved me so much, I didn't even hesitate. I said, yes, Jesus, I'll suffer for you. Now, looking back on that, I was like, oh, okay. What that looked like was literally every single sports season, except for one, from then on, all the way through college, 4 years of college basketball, I got injured and had to miss games in some way, every sport, including golf. I know, it's impressive, okay? I can literally go from the top of my head to the tips of my toes with injuries. I've had concussions, broken noses, broken wrists, broken thumbs. This is my worst one. I got hit by a pitch in baseball that led to separated cartilage in my rib cage that turned into pneumonia. Mm-hmm. Broken ankles, broken toes. One time, do you remember the game Foursquare? You know that stupid, yeah. Yeah, okay, fair enough. I was like, I love that game. Yeah, fair enough. I'm with you. I was running to be the king, and I jumped because I wanted to be the king, and I landed, and my ankle exploded. Yeah. And so what would happen over and over again is I would get hurt, and I'd go to the emergency room where they knew my name, which is not the place you want everyone to know your name. They'd be like, hey, Pete, welcome back. And I'd be like, hey, you know, good to see you. How are the kids? You know, And then I'd come home, and I was usually pretty sweaty because it was at a practice or something, and I'd be in the shower, and I'd be throwing the soap around the shower because I'd be so mad that I couldn't believe I got hurt again. And outside the door of the bathroom, my mom would just walk, and she'd go, just give it to Jesus, you know. And I'd be like, and then I would. Why? Because he was real, and he loved me. And because he loved me, I loved him. And I didn't want to get hurt. But I just kept giving it to him. So heading into my freshman year of high school, I just knew that God was real and he loved me, and I was just ready to go. So if it asked freshman year Pete Burak, what's high school going to look like? I would have said, I'm going to win a state championship in every sport I play. Somewhat prideful. And then I would have said, and I'm going to help convert all the heathens in our high school, right? Yeah, I know, kind of weird. But what had happened is the summer before my freshman year, my eyes, which had been fixed on Jesus, started to be fixed on myself. I started to be fascinated with myself, and I started to be thinking about, like, wow, isn't this amazing what God is doing and what this means and yada, yada, yada. It all became about me. So, first day at freshman year, high school, I come up to the door of the school, ready to go, let's go, look out world, here comes Pete Burak. I throw open the door, I start walking down the hallway. In order to get to my locker, I had to weave through the senior hallway. And as I started to weave through the senior hallway, it was something out of a bad teen movie. There was like a kid up against the locker over here and a couple doing something over here. And I don't even know, but by the time I got to my locker, in my mind, it was like pure debauchery that I had just wandered through, okay? And I got to my locker, which I couldn't open because I was a freshman, and I put my head up against, this is true, I actually like put my head up against the locker and I said, oh man, those seniors are big and bad, and you know what? I don't think I want them to know that I know Jesus. And so I just took my faith and I put it in my back pocket and kept him there during the school day. As soon as I left the doors of the school, I'd bring him out like an old coat so that my parents wouldn't notice anything was different. And as soon as I got back to the school, if you'd asked any of my freshman classmates, does Pete know Jesus? They would have been like, that's a weird question. And then they would have been like, I have no idea. He's a good guy. He's a good athlete. Pretty good student. But I have no idea if he knows Jesus. And so I started to live that way. One way at school, one way at home. One way at school, one way at home. Talking one way here, talking another way there. Imagination over here in one way, imagination over here in the other way. And what that happens when you live in two different kingdoms, when you live two different stories, is what happens is you lose your identity. That's the main thing, friends. You will lose your identity when you try to live by two different stories, when you try to live by two different kingdoms, because there are two different values, there's two different narratives, there's two different outcomes. So about halfway through my freshman year, I had no idea who I was. No idea who I was anymore. Until the defining moment of my life. I'm sitting at an all-school mass. We're in a Catholic school, go to mass once a week together. I'm sitting about, right about there where that guy just yawned. And I'm checked out. I'm not listening to Father's homily because why should I? And I'm sitting there kind of slouched like this. And all of a sudden this feeling comes over me like something's about to happen. And so I sit up a little straighter and I tune into what Father's saying. And he's giving a normal homily. And then all of a sudden, he stops, like right in the middle of a sentence. And he just goes, okay, how many of you, you know, he goes, if any of you have ever experienced God, he says, please stand up. So some people stand up over here, and some people stand up over here, and some people stand up in the back. And I think he was expecting like most of the church to be standing, because it's a Catholic school, for goodness sakes. And here I am sitting there having profoundly experienced God for years. I couldn't stand up. I wanted to. I knew I was lying, but I couldn't do it. The weight of the peer pressure, the weight of the two different lives, the weight of a loss of identity was like forcing me into the pew. And so Father is a little alarmed, so he makes it a little easier on us. He says, okay, how about, have you ever seen a mountain or a beautiful ocean or something in nature that has drawn your heart towards God? And he's like, so please stand up. And so now more people stand up over here and more people stand up over here. And the row behind me stands up. For the second time, I couldn't stand up. I wanted to, but I was like rooted to the pew. I knew I was lying, but I couldn't do anything about it. Now Father is quite distressed. So he makes it even easier. He goes, okay, how many of you have ever, been smiled at or received a really good hug and felt loved in any way, shape, or form and attributed that love in any way to God? He's like, stand up. Now the whole choir stands up. You know, people are literally, most of the church at this point is standing. And for the third time, I couldn't stand up. I wanted to, but I couldn't get on my feet. I was too scared. I was too broken. I was too lacking in identity to simply stand up. Now, there was one really important person who was standing, and that was my mom. because she came to every all-school mass, and she's standing in the back of the church shooting lasers into the back of my head wondering why I'm not standing, right? And my parents, you probably don't remember what my name is, but my name is Pete, short for Peter. My parents, my mom was always like, yeah, I was expecting a rooster to crow, you know? Like, ha, ha, ha. One of you really liked that, yeah. Good old Bible jokes, yeah. Yeah. Some of you didn't get that, which is why you're at Ave Maria University, okay. And so the rest of the day, I'm miserable because I knew I had denied the Lord. I knew I had straight up said that I didn't know the man. And my mom leaves the church crying because she couldn't believe that her son, who she thought knew Jesus, wouldn't even stand on his feet when asked if he had gotten a good hug. So she calls my dad, crying. And my dad says, Emily, this is the best thing that's ever happened to him. And they hatched a plan. They called it Come to Jesus 2.0. And so I come home, and I open the front door, and I wish you knew my mom. She's lovely, but she has a flair for the dramatic. I open the door, and there was a pathway of used tissues leading me into the bedroom, okay? Or excuse me, into the living room, because she had been crying all afternoon, you know, and wanted me to know about it. So I followed the path into the living room, and sure enough, there she is, eyes all red, nose all red, and she's like, why didn't you stand up? And I was like, I don't know. And she goes, you sit right there until your father gets home. Which, you know, everybody's favorite phrase. So I sat down, and my dad was an amazing man, very gentle dude, but the man that came through the front door had a fire in his heart and a fire in his eyes. And I'm forever grateful for it, because he came flying into that living room. And at the end of our conversation, we were standing face to face, him kind of gently but firmly holding the front of my shirt, shaking me, going, who are you? Who are you? He said. Are you the man I thought you were? Or are you some chicken, you know what, who won't even stand up when asked if you know the Lord? He said, who are you? He said, you need to decide today, son, who you're going to serve. You need to decide today what you believe. And then he said, and if you don't choose Jesus, I'm taking you out of that Catholic school because I'm not paying for all that tuition just for you not to believe it. And then he shook me again. He said, you need to decide today. And so you can guess what happened, right? I said, all right, I'm gonna decide for Jesus. I'm going to stand up for him. God is real and he loves me, and I'm going to stand up for him. And it hasn't been perfect, and it hasn't been always, and I found myself at different points, like that time in Illinois, 2 feet in, 1 foot in the kingdom, 1 foot out. My whole time on the Michigan basketball team, I had 1 foot in, 1 foot out. But every time, I keep coming back to the fact that Jesus is the Lord of my life. Who is Jesus to me? He's the King. He's the Lord. He's my Savior and my friend. He's my everything. And what am I going to do about him? What am I going to do about it? He gets everything. It's all his. I'm living by his kingdom, not the kingdom of the world. And that's what we're leaving with tonight. Who is Jesus to you? And what are you going to do about it? Because honestly, this is the time in your life where you get to make these decisions about what your identity is going to be. Are you going to receive your identity and let it be bestowed on you? Or are you going to create it for yourself? Are you going to make it up as you go? Two kingdoms, two stories. You get to choose. Amen? Amen.